The mountain tops, we hear cries. find its inmost melody.
Bow your heads and just give to the Lord whatever is distracting today, whatever you come in here and maybe you have something heavy on your heart or a burden or something. We want to just align our hearts and our minds and our wills and our emotions to the Lord today. So let's take a moment just in the quiet to do that right now. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to be in this place together to remind ourselves of that we come in here and we don't worship an idea or a philosophy or a concept, but we worship you, and you are present here. You, in some way, you have taken your abode within all who have put their trust in Christ Jesus. And you say you're with us always to the end of the age, Lord, so we welcome you here. And we want to put our attention on you today. We want to meet with you and offer just a bare minimum that we can of hearts that are just grateful for who you are and what you have done for us, Lord. We want to be reminded this morning of this incredible love that you have for us. And it says in Romans, it says, what then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died, more than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from this love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Every child he reconciles.
Lord, thank you for your incredible love for us, Lord. Thank you for this time today that we get to gather together to remind ourselves of that, to put our attention on you. May you be glorified in this place. And I pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 So our kids are dismissed, and while you guys are standing, go ahead and look around, find somebody you don't know, and greet them with a holy kiss right there. Not really. And a happy Labor Day weekend to everybody. It's great to see you here. My name's Tim Beard. I'm one of the pastors, and it's good to be here together to worship. If it's one of your first times here and we don't know about you, would you do me a favor and look in the row in front of you? You'll see a Connect card. If you could grab one of those, give us your name, email address, and phone number, drop it in one of the offering boxes on your way out of the sanctuary today. And we'll just shoot you an email. We'll invite you to an upcoming lunch with the pastors, which is coming up the last Sunday of this month. So welcome. Good to see everybody. If you've been coming to DCC, you know that we are going through this season as we move into the fall, where we're doing a little bit of a community group focus. So I want you to keep your eyes on the screen and check out this video all about community
groups. Hey, DCC family. I am so excited to be sharing you a little bit about our community groups. At DCC, we firmly believe that we were not meant to do life alone, that we were designed to be in relationship with the Lord and then relationship with one another. So that's why we find community groups so important. In community groups, that's really where you get to live out the Christian life with one another, get to point each other to Jesus. In community groups, growth happens in your spiritual walk and also growth in your relationships with one another. And so if you're not connected to one, if you haven't joined a community group yet, we so encourage you to do that. So practically, what does that look like? What are community groups like at DCC? Well, our groups meet either weekly or bi-monthly. Every community group studies the Bible, every community group prays together, and every community group prioritizes, most importantly, community and building relationship with one another. However, each community group that we have incorporates those components that I just listed in different ways. Each community group is unique and special based on location, stage of life, or just how they decide to meet together, which is why we're highlighting our community groups for you to choose and see which one would be the best fit for you. So if you're interested in joining a community group, go to our website, dunwoodychurch.org/connect, or you can fill out the green decision card in front of you and turn it into the welcome table. We are so excited for this season of community groups, and we hope you'll join us in diving deeper into community.
And once again, I want to say that Becca did such a great job on that. And the unspoken, the hero also, who never gets talked about, is Jared, who does those videos. But you can never have too much Becca. So I'm going to ask Becca and Chris to come on up, and we're going to be talking about. Each Sunday we kind of highlight one of our community groups, and today we get to hear all about your community group, which used to be the young adults group, but you guys got older. So we have another young adults group, but you guys are the older young adults group, or maybe not the, what are you now?
We are officially the 20s and 30s group now.
Gotcha. That's good. So tell us about your group logistically, like when do you meet, where do you meet, all those kind of things.
Yeah, so we meet at the church on Thursday nights at 7:30. We'll usually do probably about a half hour of fellowship in the beginning, and then the lesson will start from 8, usually goes until about 9:30, and then we do more fellowship afterwards.
So you get out of the building at what time? Because I know, like for me, 9:30 is like, see ya, but how late are you here?
It varies. The goal is to finish the study at 9:30, and then afterwards, anyone can stick around as long as they want. If we get home the next day, technically, that's purely by choice.
Okay, good. So tell us the kind of things that you guys are studying. Like, what does it look like when you do your studies?
So we have done a variety of studies. We tend to like to do studies that help guide us through a book of the Bible. We've done studies on what it means to live out the gospel. We really like deep spiritual discussion, and so our discussions are always really fruitful and fun to hear different people's perspectives. But we haven't decided our study yet for this year. So you'll have to come if you're interested this Thursday to find out what it is.
Okay, other than the surprise element of what it's going to be, and we need people who can stay up late at night, why should we choose you? What's great about your group, or what's unique about your group?
Yeah, so I think kind of what Becca said in the video is like doing life together. So we will show up for people a lot. It's kind of the stage of life where a lot of different things are going on. So we've moved so many people. We've been in each other's weddings. You know, we'll do events outside of the group. We do a lot of just time together as social things. So that's, I think, probably what would set us apart.
Awesome. Stay up late, read the Bible, and if you are planning on moving at any time soon or you're getting married, this is a group for you. So let's give them a big hand. Thank you so much, guys. Good job. Okay, so I'm going to invite Beth Abbott and Christine Rather to come up. Are they both in here? And they're going to talk about something. And Christine, what are you going to talk about? Here you go.
Hey, everybody. I am so excited to talk to you about what God is doing to reach our kids and our youth in our communities. Dunwoody Community Church has opened their doors to host community Bible study, small groups for our elementary age kids, boys and girls, and right now, middle school girls. And we're going to take a deep dive into Ephesians this fall. We're going to walk together and learn about what God has to say about that and how that applies to their lives right now, and talk with their peers. And it's just, they have a wonderful curriculum. We have fun, and it's a safe place to learn and laugh and grow together in God. So I'm just so excited to see what God wants to do to transform these young lives. So if you have more if you have questions, please meet me out at the kids' table after the service. Thank you.
And speaking of the next generation, so back in the back, maybe if you don't have kids back there or grandkids back there, you may not know what we're doing or what we're studying. So we have a couple of kids from the back who want to share some of the things that they've been working on and learning. We have a memory verse every month, and we've also been trying to learn the Lord's Prayer. So the Estes children are going to do our memory verse from last month, right? All right, ready?
And may you have the power to understand, as all God's people should, how wide, how long, how high, and how deep his love is. Ephesians 3:18.
They've been working on that for several weeks. We're very proud of them. And then Reese is going to close us out as we dismiss ourselves back there in the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Thank you all so much for that. So that's what's going on with our DCC kids. Also want to let you know, for our youth ministry, we have Michael Kane back here. Michael, stand up in case people don't know who you are. New youth ministry director. Jared informed me this morning that the hut has never been so clean or never smelled so good. So thanks for getting, at least for a little bit here. So thanks for all the hard work you guys are doing there. But they'll be kicking off the youth ministry next Sunday after church. They'll be meeting after church in the hut. And then they're also going to start on Wednesday nights, the following Wednesday after that. So Michael's back there. You'll see him after the service if you want more information about that. Also, real quickly, want to let you know a couple studies are going to be starting in a couple of weeks on the 17th of September at 9 o'clock, Larry Heron and Eric Svensson, a couple of our elders, are going to be starting a study on kind of the foundations of the Christian faith. So that'll be offered on Sunday mornings at 9 o'clock. If you'd like to be a part of that, I would encourage you to do so. And also beginning on the, let me see, where is all, lots of things going on the 13th of September, correct? Maybe is, well, you're teaching it. Is that when you started? Sometime in September, I think it's the 13th, on a Wednesday night, we're going to start doing Wednesday night classes here. And Bob Hart, one of our elders, is going to be doing a class about talking about end times. And then Jeff and Dante Hawkins, did you know this, Jeff, are going to be doing a class on conversational evangelism. Good, he knows, that's good. Go to In the Loop or Fellowship, I'm sorry, Fellowship, I keep doing that. dunwoodychurch.org/events. And you can register for either one of those classes. So lots of opportunities to get connected. We don't do these just because we don't have anything to do on Sunday mornings or Wednesday nights. We do it because we want to equip one another and encourage one another to be disciples who make disciples. So we're really intentional about all this. So the final thing I want to do before I call Bob Hart up to pray for Jeff is Mr. and Mrs. Estes, there's a clipboard right here. Now, I found out something a couple of weeks ago. We need to get a lot of volunteers for our community yard sale. And I would stand up here and I talk about I need people to sign up. And very few people signed up. But we passed out a clipboard and we got everything completely filled up. So here's my need. Here's my ask. I'm going to give you multiple reasons of why you should do this. Okay? Did you guys see the big pile of mulch out here in the next to the back entrance? Did you notice that? Go look at that pile of mulch. It's a wonderful pile of mulch, but it shouldn't be in the sidewalk. It needs to go into our children's playground because we want to have a nice, comfortable, neat, safe place for our kids to play. So this coming Saturday at 9 o'clock, and if we get enough people here, and I'll take male and female, you know, I'm not going to distinguish between that, but if you have a wheelbarrow, bonus. If you have like another rake, bonus. But if we can get a bunch of people to be here at 9 o'clock this Saturday, we can knock that out really, really quickly. I've got a lot of stuff I've got to do that day, as so do you. But if we get a lot of people here, we can get that knocked out really quickly. Here's a couple of reasons why this should be important to you. One, our kids. Raise your hand if you love our kids here. 90% of our people love our kids. I love that. So for the 90% of you who love our kids, come on out here. The other reason you should be here is because I'm not getting any younger, and I'm going to be here. I'm going to have my wheelbarrow, and you don't want to see me walking into church the next day like this. So either you love your kids or you love Tim. Either way, I'll take either one. I'll make coffee. I'll bring donuts. This Saturday, man, if we get enough people, we can knock it out in a couple hours. We can go, 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 go. And so I want to encourage you. We're going to pass the clipboard around. And I'm hoping that when I see that clipboard at the end of the service, it's going to be full of people who say, yes, Tim, I'm going to be here because I love you or I love our children. So this Saturday at 9 o'clock, we'll knock that thing out. So, Bob, why don't you come on up and pray for Pastor Jeff as we do week 2 of our new series.
Before I pray, I'll give you a clarification. You can pick one of these up out in the lobby. It has a website on it. So in addition to teaching a class on Wednesday evenings, you don't have to be here. You can just tune in and call on a Zoom call. You don't have to sign up for it. If you get bored, you can hang up. Nobody will know. So it will start on September the 13th at 7. You can probably, you know, get into the chat room about 10 minutes ahead of time. And you know, like I said, if you get bored, just hang up. Nancy and I are going on vacation the next week, so I'm going to skip the next week, which is the 20th, and then it will be on subsequent Wednesday nights, every Wednesday night for a number of Wednesday nights. So it'll resume on September the 27th. So let's pray together. Lord, we thank you that you have us assembled here. We're a small part of Jesus's bride and in this location, and we are rejoicing that you bring us together to hear your word, to fellowship with one another, and to lift up our our praises and our thanksgiving to you. And we remember who you are and how mighty you are and that you love us. And I pray, Father, that you'll work in each one of us, Father, by your Holy Spirit, so that you'll inform our understanding and give us insight into what Jeff is teaching as he teaches this morning after preparing diligently and studying to bring this message to us. So we ask, Father, that you would be changing us, that you would be causing your word to be planted in our hearts and minds, that we'll be transformed by the renewing of our minds in your word, and that we'll become more and more like Christ Jesus in each one of us. We ask these things in his name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Bob. All right, turn in your Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 2. We are talking about suffering. Aren't you glad you came to church on Labor Day? Woohoo! Specifically, we're talking about what happens when the culture and the faith diverge. You know, 100 years ago, if you had said America was a Christian nation, nobody would have batted an eye. Today, if you say that, you'll find that's a very offensive statement for a lot of people. 100 years ago, to be a Christian was the norm, which in some case wasn't great, because Christians and non-Christians looked almost identical, except one went to church and the other didn't. Today, that difference is becoming more and more distinct. There are people, you don't have to, okay, I realize it's the internet, so, but you don't have to go far on the internet to find people who will say that Christianity itself is a force for evil, and that Christians are themselves evil, and something needs to be done about them. Our culture and our faith are diverging, and that means we're going to have issues. We're going to have problems. And this is not the first time this has happened. As I told you last week, history is replete with instances where the culture and the faith opposed each other. And wow, most of the time, the church grew like wildfire in those times. Not always, but most of the time, when the culture opposed and oppressed the faith has grown and grown and grown. And I told you last week, the two reasons when that happens, the two reasons we see are, one is the Christians have better answers, because the whole world's got the same questions. Where did I come from? Where am I going? What matters? Why am I here? And the Christians had better lives. And so I told you about times when the Roman Empire was persecuting the Christians, and the gladiators would come out to kill a group of Christians, and the Christians would pray over the gladiators as they came first, and they wouldn't fight back because they wouldn't harm the men who were coming to kill them. And so you see gladiators start to embrace the faith because they're not that strong and they're not that brave. When the faith and the culture collide, that's when the reality of the faith is seen. And Peter is writing in one of those times. He's writing in the early 60s, when the Roman Empire has realized that Christians aren't Jews. They thought up until now Christians were Jews. They didn't like Jews, but they didn't care about them because Jews kept to themselves. Jews had their own houses of worship. They had their own businesses. They had their own homes. They didn't eat with non-Jews. They didn't do business with non-Jews. They were totally separate. The Romans really don't like Jews because Jews won't worship the emperor, and that's what holds the empire together. You have religious freedom in the Roman Empire. You can worship anyone you want. You just also need to worship the empire. You got to worship the emperor as well. Jews refused to do that. Jews refused to worship the gods of the Roman Empire, and that frightened the authorities. Because if you're not worshiping the gods, then they might get mad at us. But the Jews kept to themselves. Wow, late 50s, early 60s, the empire figures out the Christians don't stay to themselves. They're not off in their corner doing their thing. They are out in the marketplaces talking to people. They are trying to turn good Roman citizens who go to all the right religious festivals and worship the right gods and burn a pinch of incense to the emperor like everyone else does. They're trying to turn good citizens into bad citizens. Citizens who don't worship the right gods and don't go to the right services and refuse to burn a pinch of incense to the emperor. They're trying to turn the empire inside out. And they get very nervous and they start to crack down on Christians. And you'll see that pattern of cyclic oppression from the empire. This is the first time it happens in the very early 60s. And Peter is writing, probably from Rome, a few years before the empire will kill him. He will be executed for being a leader of one of this outlawed cult known as Christians. And he's writing to Christians in modern day Turkey and the Caucasus around the Black Sea about persecution and about suffering. So We've said Christians had better answers. That's what we're going to do on Wednesday nights on the class that future Jeff needs to worry about on the 13th when that happens. That, how do we answer people? How do we answer people's questions? Everyone's got the same questions throughout history. How do we answer that in a way that's satisfying to them? We're going to talk about that. We're going to discuss it. We're going to role play. We're going to work through, yes, how do we do that? And then here, as we go through the book of 1 Peter, we're looking at, okay, how do we live better lives? What does it mean for us to be under persecution, for people to be threatened by this faith and to think that's a terrible thing? Why are you doing that? That's a force for bad. It's harmful. That's what the Romans thought about the Christians. That's what a lot of people today think about Christians. So 1 Peter chapter 1, read along with me. We're picking right up where we left off last week, starting in verse 3, and I'm going to read down to verse 12. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he's given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In all this you greatly rejoice, though now, for a little while, you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. These have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith, of far greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealald. Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you don't see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. For you are receiving the end result of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Concerning this salvation, the prophets who spoke of the grace that was to come to you searched intently and with the greatest care, trying to find out the time and circumstances to which the Spirit of Christ in them was pointing when they predicted the sufferings of the Messiah and the glories that would follow. It was revealed to them that they were not serving themselves, but you, when they spoke of things that have now been told to you by those who have preached the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven. Even angels long to look into these things. So I've told you this is an ancient letter, and ancient letters follow a particular format, just like our modern letters do. They don't say to and love at the end. They say from and then to. And then what we would expect in verse 3 is for him to say something nice about his recipients. That would be the normal thing you would do. You know, we have it in our letter, right? When you write an email or something, you don't just jump right into the business usually. That would be rude. You have some chit-chat or some small talk. You would expect him to say something nice about them or to say something like, I'm so glad that I get to write you. Because, and you'll hear Paul will do this if you think of his letters. Because your faith is known all throughout the world, and you say something encouraging to the people that you're writing. And interestingly, Peter doesn't do that. That's a little odd. Peter instead says something about God. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Peter starts out right off the bat talking about God and what God has done. By God's mercy, God has given us these things. And did you hear the things he said? You got a new birth. You got a new life. You've got hope after death. You've got resurrection from the dead. Like Peter says, God has turned our whole world upside down. Now remember, he's writing to Christians who are suffering for being Christians. And we're going to get there. If you flip through your Bible and you've got headings, right? My chapter heading for chapter 2 says, living godly lives in a pagan society, which is exactly one of the things we're going to talk about. How do we live good lives when we're being persecuted, when we're suffering? Chapter 3, suffering for doing good. Chapter 4, suffering for being a Christian, right? He's going to get to the suffering part, but that's not where he starts. He doesn't start with, hey, I know you're suffering. Here's what you need to do. He starts with God. In this whole first chapter that we started last week and we'll finish next week, there's one verse about suffering. All the rest, he's talking about other things. And here he starts talking about God. He says, God has given you a new birth. He's given you a new life. He's given you a new hope. He's given you a share in the resurrection of the dead. He's given you a new inheritance. I mean, you've got birth, life, death, after death, the whole nine yards. Peter says God has completely changed your life. He's given you an inheritance that can't perish, spoil, or fade. Those are really cool words. Perish means to rot. It means to break down, to fall apart, because everything in our world does that. There's nothing you can make that will last forever. We know. I mean, that's a fundamental principle of physics, right? Minimum energy, maximum randomness. Everything is going to fall apart in this world, but not what God has prepared for you as a Christian. It will never fall apart. It will never spoil. That means it can't become defiled. It can't become bad. Think about all the things in your life that you thought were going to be great, and they weren't. You thought, oh, if only I buy this car, then I won't have those problems again. Yeah, and it didn't work out that way. If only I get this degree, if only I have this relationship, all these things in life that we think, oh, this is going to be so good, and then it's not good. Peter says, that's not going to happen. Your inheritance, it's good, and it will always stay good. It can never fade. It's the word for a flower. It's what happens to a flower. Flowers, they're so beautiful. You get a flower and you set it there and it's so beautiful. And then it's not. And eventually, if like me, who gives flowers and then forgets about them, right, you will come in one day and find that they're gone. And you will ask your wife, oh, what happened to the flowers? And she will say, they were disgusting and I threw them away. Well, they weren't disgusting when I gave them to her. They were beautiful. Everything in our world fades. And Peter says, not what God has prepared for you. What God has prepared for you will never fade. It will never fall apart. It will never become bad. It will never stop being beautiful. And he goes on to say in verse 4, it's kept in heaven for you. And we don't have a way in English to translate this really well. But he's not saying it's being guarded right now. He's saying it as if he's standing off at the end of time, looking back on it. He's like, you have to say something like, it's already been kept for you. It's already there. Okay, I'm a sci-fi geek, right? Obligatory sci-fi reference. Everybody know what a stasis field is? There's a way to turn off time. So thank you, I see that hand. Turn off time into something, right? So nothing happens, right? It's as if God's taken your inheritance and put it in a stasis field. Nothing's ever happened. It's never going to change. It's always going to be exactly there. Paul says it as if he's looking backwards from when we finally get there at the resurrection. He's like, oh yeah, of course it's there. Your inheritance, it's a done deal because it's God who's keeping it. All right, if you remember nothing else from this message, okay, remember this because we're going to say it over and over again. It's not you, it's God. It is not you that keeps your inheritance. Paul can't look. Paul, standing here at this point in time, they're going to live their lives. Who knows what's going to happen? Paul can't say, oh, it's a done deal. I can see it. I know that you received that inheritance. But he can because it's God. And if God says it, then it's going to happen. If I say it, who knows? But if God says it, it's going to happen. And God has said it. God has said he has already kept this for you. It's there. It is absolutely going to be there. When you rise from the dead as a follower of Christ, when we sang about it, when Jesus rises and we rise with him, boom, it's going to be there. The inheritance is absolutely kept. And he says, you are absolutely going to be there. There is no question that inheritance will be there, and there is no question that you will be there. Verse 5, you who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. By God's power, not by your power. You're not guaranteed to be there to get that inheritance because you're so powerful and you're so smart and you have so much faith and you're so good at being a Christian. It's not you. It's God. You are shielded by God's power. Nothing is going to happen to that inheritance. It's going to be there. And nothing is going to happen to you. You are going to be there because you are shielded by God and his power. Not by your own. Peter doesn't say, you will have this great inheritance if you fill in the blank. Peter says, you will have this great inheritance because God has already. It's not you. It's God. God has already done all of these things for you. Your inheritance will be there, and you will be there, because the power of God will make sure it happens. And finally, in verse 6, now he gets to us. All this stuff has been praised to God. God did this. God did this. You get this because God did it. God gave this to you. Finally, in verse 6, in this, all of you, what do? We rejoice, because this is joyful. Again, we sing about it every week. This is a gift, and it's joyous. God has done all this for you. It's not you. You don't have to keep yourself. You don't have to screw your courage to the sticking point. You don't have to convince yourself that you have enough faith. You're not shielded by anything that you do. You're shielded by God's power. And folks, God is powerful enough to shield you. God will have no trouble. I mean, I get it. I am not powerful enough to shield you. God will have no trouble shielding you until that day. Just like as far as Paul says, in fact, it's already happened. Your inheritance is already there. God will shield you until that day. In all this you greatly rejoice. And now finally we get the one half a sentence about suffering. Even though, yep, right now, it's true. For a little while, you suffer grief in all kinds of trials. You know, Peter, he's not going to pretend like they're not suffering. He's not going to tell them, oh, it's all in your mind. He's not going to act like, no, that's not a big deal. Again, the whole rest of the book after chapter 1 is going to be about suffering and how we live in suffering. But where he starts is with God. He puts suffering in its proper place with God and what God is doing. He contrasts our suffering to what God has done for us and what God will do for us. And listen to what he says in the very next verse. In verse 7, all these trials, all this suffering, all these issues, all this grief in your life, these have come so that. Now seriously, don't you want to know the end of that sentence? You are suffering. Here's why. Here's what, or really, it's purpose. Here's what's going to happen. Here's the reason. Here's what God is doing. Now, this is not the only thing Scripture says about suffering. There's lots of other things. But this is absolutely true in suffering. God is always doing this, Peter says, when we suffer. These griefs, these trials, these things that have happened to you, they have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith. If you've got another translation, like nobody translates this the same, because we don't have it in English. I looked up the ESV, calls it the trusted genuineness. The CSV calls it the proven character. The NASB calls it just the proof of your faith. In our world, tests are very different from in their world. In our world, a test, we think of it like school. Like, you know, Jeff, you say you can read Greek, so we'll test you. Right? When I started seminary, right, I wrote to the seminary folks and said, hey, I already know Greek and I already know Hebrew. Right? They didn't write back to me and say, oh, great, you don't have to take those classes. They wrote back to me and said, great, you can take the final exam. You take the final exam for Greek and the final exam for Hebrew. If you pass, then you don't have to take those classes. They didn't just believe me, they tested me. I had to take the test. And I either pass the test or I fail the test. If I pass the test, I don't have to take the classes. If I fail the test, I do have to take the classes. That's how we think of testing. We're going to prove whether it's true or not. You say you know Greek and Hebrew, so we'll test you. These guys don't have school like we have school. This is not their world. Testing for them is a metallurgy term. It's what you do to metals. In fact, when he talks about the gold being refined by fire, that word refined, it's the same word as trials. It's the same root, because in their world, you test metals. The metal, when you take a hunk of gold and you put it in the fire, that doesn't make it gold. That doesn't prove it's gold. Of course, we already know it's gold. That's why we're putting it in the fire. We took it out of a gold mine. We know there's gold in there. A test gets rid of the junk. Testing is refining. It's burning off the dross. It doesn't change the gold. We don't, like, you pull out a thing of gold and then you put it in the fire. When it comes out of the fire, we don't go, okay, now it's gold. It wasn't gold before now, but it's gold. It was always gold. It was always gold. The testing is to get rid of all the other junk that was going on in there. Remember, Peter says, you already have a new life. You already have faith. You already have an inheritance. You already have a share in the resurrection. God did all those things. Those things are true. We don't have to give a test, a modern day pass fail test. God did that. It's true. End of discussion. The testing is not to see if you have faith. That's not the way they talk in this world. That's not what those words mean. That's why we have to come up with these terms, you know, like the proven genuineness of your faith. Because we don't have something that says, you know, we took this hunk of gold and we put it in the fire and we burned off all the junk. We just left the gold. The gold was always gold. There was just lots of other junk mixed in there with it. We want to get rid of the junk and get to gold. You're not being tested to see if you have faith. When suffering comes, God isn't up there wondering, okay, well, are you going to pass the test? Gold doesn't pass a test. It's gold. I think that's why he uses it as the example. The gold is gold. The gold doesn't change in the fire. It was gold before it went in the fire. It is gold afterwards. Oh, what changes is everything else. I mean, let's face it. If you were a Christian, we have a junk to Jesus ratio in our lives, don't we? Right? You know, on good days, wow, I hope it's like 1-to-1. There's as much Jesus in my life as there is junk. On bad days, oh, it's more like 5% Jesus and 95% junk. But we have this ratio in our lives between Jesus and junk, all the other stuff. Between, yep, I trust him, I know what scripture says, I'm going to do it, and that's crazy, I'm going to take this into my own hands. I don't care what the Bible says, that's nuts. Testing. Testing doesn't prove you have this. You already have this. God gave it to you. God did that. Again, it's not you, it's God. God did that. God didn't mess it up. You absolutely have faith if you are a Christian. We're changing the Jesus to junk ratio by burning out the junk. Testing gets rid of the junk. That's what Peter says God is doing. When you suffer, and again, this is not the only reason. This is not reason. This is purpose. It's not the reason you suffer. It's what God is doing with it. Because Satan has reasons for you to suffer as well, and sometimes other people have reasons they want you to suffer, and sometimes we want ourselves to suffer. But God, when God faces your suffering, this is what he does with it. God isn't wondering if you have faith. He gave it to you. He knows you have it. That is not his worry, whether you have faith or not. He's not concerned whether you're gold or not. He knows you are. He made you gold. He wants to get rid of the junk. But have you ever watched them? Like if somebody puts, you know, puts a hunk of gold in a crucible and puts it over the fire, what happens? It gets hot. It starts to burn. It starts to glow. And then dark things start to come to the surface. We've got this beautiful gold, and then these dark blemishes start to come to the surface, and they burn, and they're bright, and you see them. Refining, testing, again, it's the same word in their language. It's the same word in their world. Refining, testing, oh, it brings that junk to the surface so it can burn it away, because before then you couldn't see it. It was all hidden down in there, mixed in with all the gold. But it turned out there's tons of other stuff mixed in with that gold. The refining, the testing, oh, it brings all of those blemishes, all of that junk, everything that's not gold, brings it to the surface and burns it off. And wow, who wants that in their life? Who wants all their blemishes on display? And they're flaring, they're burning up. Everyone can see it. I cannot speak for you, I cannot read your mind. I wanna stay in this little nugget that everybody looks at and says, oh wow, look at all that gold. And who knows the reality of what's really in there? because I polished the outside and it looks good. I don't want all those blemishes to come to the surface. I don't want all those big flares of fire that everybody can see. But God does. God wants to get rid of all that junk in our lives. That Jesus to junk ratio. Oh, he wants to raise the Jesus and lower the junk. And that's one of the things he's doing, Peter says. When we suffer, when we're tested, he's refining us. He's not trying to figure out if we have faith. He's not trying to figure out if we're gold. He already did that. He knows that, Peter says. He's burning away all of the junk. And I think, putting myself in Peter's shoes as I keep reading this, I think he gets that this is a hard concept. It's not you, it's God. It wasn't you before when you became a Christian. It's not you now as you live out your Christian life, and it will not be you on the day when Jesus brings you back from the dead. It's not you, it's God. Now, we absolutely have a role to play. We'll start into that next week. But when you suffer, it's not you. It's not you that gets through it by being just screwing your courage to the sticking point. Although you very well may have to screw your courage to the sticking point. You absolutely may have to do that. But that's not why you're going to get through it. God is at work in you, in your sufferings. And so Peter says, you know, Peter saw Jesus. This is not hypothetical for him. He talked to Jesus. He saw him come back from the dead. The guys he's writing never did. Again, they lived in modern-day Turkey and the region around the Caucasus. They're Greeks and Romans. They weren't in Jerusalem. They don't know any of this. Peter says, you know, I get it. You never saw him, and you don't see him now. But you do love him. There's something going on inside of him. You believe, and you are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. Wow, I wish it was expressible. I mean, there's times, aren't there times in your life when you feel like such an idiot because you're driving down the road and a song comes on or something and you have to pull over because you're crying and you can't see? And I wish I could explain to someone, I'm so grateful. I'm so grateful. I can think of all these times when it should not have gone right, and it did. I can think of all these times everything should have fallen apart, and it didn't. I'm so grateful. It's inexpressible. Peter says, yeah, that's God. But those times, again, they're not all the times. I mean, there's plenty of days when I wake up and I think, wow, this is really improbable, isn't it? I'm like, God became a man and died. And then there are those moments when you know. When it's so real and it makes such sense. And Peter says, yeah, God's not testing you to see if you have faith. He already knows you have faith. He gave you faith. He's burning out all the junk in your life so that you are going to eventually be nothing but gold. That's why, incidentally, what happens at the end of this? It results in praise, glory, and honor for who? Jesus. When I took those Greek and Hebrew tests, right? Who got the credit for passing those tests? Me. Because I passed them. The Greek teacher didn't get credit. He didn't do anything. He just gave me the test. Why does Jesus get the credit when we've been tested? Because if you take a nugget of gold and you give it to a jeweler and he crushes it and melts it and separates it and refines it and then pours it into a mold, and let's say he makes a gold ring out of it. You don't look at the gold ring and go, wow, that's the most amazing gold I've ever seen. Look at what that gold used to be. Look at what that gold has transformed itself into. Who knew gold could do that? Nobody praises the gold. They praise the jeweler. They praise the guy that took it from that hunk of rock and made something beautiful out of it. That's what's going to happen to us. Jesus is going to get praised because of what he did in you through all the things that you suffered and that you endured. And yep, I think, again, Peter's like, yeah, I get it. This is hard, right? And this is why you have love for Christ at times that doesn't make any sense, and you have joy that doesn't make any sense. And listen to this, verse 10. Even the prophets didn't understand this. The prophets, Elijah, Elisha, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea, Joel, Amos, all those guys, they didn't get this. They wanted to, they tried to, they worked on it. They didn't understand this either. All they knew, it says, was that God revealed to them that someone would understand it all. Isaiah writes this in about 700 BC. Surely he took our pain and bore our sufferings, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. He was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. All of us like sheep have gone astray. Each of us have turned to our own way, but the Lord has laid on him all of our sin. Did he have a clue when he wrote that? What that was going to mean? That God himself would become a man, die on a cross, take the punishment for sin for anyone who was willing to accept it? I don't think so. But Peter says, but he knew the day would come. He knew the day would come when all this would be revealed. In fact, Peter says, even the angels don't get this. The prophets didn't understand this. The angels don't understand it. It's hard for us to hang on to now. It's not you. It's God. You didn't start this. You don't keep this going, and you're not going to finish this. It is God. What we do is rejoice. Now, don't worry. There's plenty of stuff for you to do in the coming chapters. But for the moment, this is what we have to get our minds around. That when you are suffering, you are not being tested like we test things to see if they're true. You're being tested like they test things, to burn off the garbage, to get rid of the junk. So what you've got left is just gold. Not gold mixed with dirt and rock and all sorts of other stuff. Not gold that looks good but really is full of impurities, but gold that is good. It is pure. That's what Peter says we are doing, and it is a struggle. If you are in this room, you either are suffering right now or you will be. This is a fallen, broken world. You cannot escape suffering. And Paul says if you seek to live a godly life, you will suffer. If you try and follow God, I guarantee you, it's not just that the culture is diverging from the faith. I guarantee you, you will have points of suffering in your life because you follow Christ. It will cost you. And Paul says, God is using all that to refine you. All those impurities you can't see, he's bringing them all to the surface so they'll burn off and be gone. And they'll be gone forever. And he's doing all that because one day the whole universe is going to look at us and say to Jesus, wow, you started with that and ended up there? Wow. Jesus is going to get praised and honored and glorified because of all that you go through. Again, not because you're so great at going through it. The gold just sits there. The gold just sits there, gets mushed, scrunched, boiled, heated up, melted. There's nothing you can do about that. It's going to happen. God's going to do it. God's going to purify you. You just got to endure. So I'm going to pray for us this morning. Again, I know some of you are struggling. I know some of you are in suffering because you've told me. Others of you, I'm sure, am, or you're going to be. It is the nature of this fallen world. This is where we start. When Peter wants to start talking about suffering, what he starts with is God. God has done all of this. It's not you. It's God. It's not you who did this. It's not you who will get you through this. It's not you. It is the work of God and his Spirit in your life. And he saved you, and he is protecting you, and he will resurrect you, and he will give you an inheritance. And so far, your job is to go along for the ride. Your job is to sit there and endure as all those impurities are brought to the surface. As all those black spots that you didn't want anybody to know about flare up in front of everyone and then are gone. So pray with me. Lord, thank you. Gosh, thank you that this is not us, it's you. Oh my gosh, if we had to do this, if we had to stand, if we had to endure, if it was all about us, thank you that this is not a test that can be failed. Thank you that you don't test people like that. You don't need to. You already know. This is a refining to make us more like you, to make us pure, to make us fit for your kingdom. Lord God, I readily confess, I don't, that is not the way I like being made fit for your kingdom. I would rather go to a Bible study and learn it all than experience it as suffering. But I know, I'm sure my brothers and sisters know, there are things in my life which have not come out from Bible study. There are sins in my life. There are attitudes. There are things in my heart that were only driven out by suffering. And I am grateful. All right, I was not grateful at the time. You and I both know that. But I am grateful today. But Jesus, we put ourselves before you. You, our God, we, your people, we put ourselves before you and say that this is hard, that we get that the prophets didn't understand this and the angels don't understand this, and lots of times we don't understand this. Lord God, we pray that you would do exactly what Peter says you would do. You would shield us. You would guard us. Just as you have made sure that our inheritance will be there, you are making sure that we will be there. Lord, hang on to us. Do not let go, because you know we will let go of you over and over again. You know how fickle we are. You know that we are not patient. We are not strong. We do not endure. Thank you, Jesus, that it is not up to us. It is not about us. It is not us who will get us there. It is you and your power, whatever we suffer and whatever happens. However we respond, it is you and your power who will bring us safely through home. Thank you. We are so grateful, Lord. Help us to hang on to that in the midst of trials. Help us to hang on to that when things are hard. Lord, help us to remember that when you seem distant, when you don't seem to be talking to us and everything seems to be going wrong. When as Lewis says in the Screwtape letters, we look out at a universe that seems entirely empty of you. Jesus, hang on to us. And I know that you will. You have promised that. It is not us, it is you. You will hang on to that, us. You will see us safely home. You will guard us. Help us, Lord. We want to be faithful until then. We want to suffer well. We want to do all the things that Peter's going to tell us about in this book. But wow, we want to start here. Even if we never do anything Peter tells us about in this book, your power guards us. Because it is not us, it's you. Thank you. Thank you. We are so, so grateful. Lord, we pray all of these things in your name because you are our God. Amen. Now, we'll close this time as we always do. We will do what Jesus told us to do. We'll remember. All this is possible because of what he did. All the things that Isaiah wrote, they're all true. They make all these things. God did all this. Peter said, it is all through the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. So we will remind ourselves. There are stations set up in all four corners. There's gluten-free down here to my right if you need that. I'm going to pray for us again. And then if you will go to any of these five stations, get the bread, get the cup, bring it back to your seat. I'll lead us and we'll take it all together as we remember what Jesus has done for this. This started with Jesus. It's Jesus at work in us now, and it will be Jesus who sees us through. It will be Jesus who brings us back from the dead. So pray with me. Thank you, Lord. Again, we know the truth of what Scripture says, that we weren't working real hard and doing everything right, and then you looked down and said, oh, they're so great, I'll save them. You were our enemy. We hated you. We wanted nothing to do with you. We wanted nothing to do with the way you ran the world. We absolutely refused to live in submission to you and your kingdom. We went our own way. Just like Isaiah says, all of us like sheep, we all did whatever we wanted. And you saw us and had mercy on us. You saw us wandering around like idiotic lost sheep, ready to wander off whatever cliff happened to be there. We were not following you, and you had mercy on us. In your great love for us, you said yes to your Father, putting all of our sin on you. And after all of that, you defeated death itself. Like Peter says, we have all this because you have beaten death. You have come back from the dead, and you did not stay dead, so we will not stay dead. Thank you. Lord, that's all we can say. You know, and we know we're not going to pay this back. We're not going to get this right. We're going to try as best we can. With your help, we are going to live as well as we can. But you know, and we know, we are never going to repay you for this. Thank you. We're so, so grateful. Jesus, accept this time as we remember your body, your blood. Accept this time as worship, just like when we sing and when we pray. We pray all this in your name, Jesus. You are our Savior and our God. We are your people. Amen. These are the words of Paul the Apostle to the church in Corinth. What I received from the Lord is what I pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this and remember me." So, brothers and sisters, let's remember our Lord. In the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it, and remember me." Let's remember our Lord. For whenever you eat this bread, whenever you drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he returns. If you'll put that cup in the little cup holder in the seat in front of you, and while you're doing that, pray with me one more time. Thank you, Lord. We always say that here. We always will. Thank you. Thank you. We are so grateful that you have traded your life for ours. We are so grateful that you have defeated death. We chose that. You didn't make a world that had death in it. We chose to go our own way, to not live under your rules, and so we let death in. And you have not allowed death to have the final word. Thank you. We are so, so grateful. And so, Jesus, as your grateful people, we pray again that you will help us to hang on to this truth. This truth that even the prophets didn't fully understand. That it is all you. That you have done these things for us. Even when we suffer, you are at work for our good. How can that be? And yet it is. Peter's not the only one to say that. Lord, help us to hang on to that in those times when we do suffer, when we must endure. Remind us that you are burning away the junk in our lives. That one day you will receive praise and glory and honor from what you made us into. Thank you. We're so grateful, Lord. Now we pray, as we close out this service and song, we pray that you would accept the worship of your grateful people. Amen. Stand with me. Let's sing again.
Then through the darkness.
before the Lamb of God and sing. You're worthy of it all.
Jesus. Jesus, as we go from here, we remind ourselves that apart from you, we don't have anything. You are our strength, you are our hope, and you're the peace bringer. And we thank you for that. Pray that you would embolden us throughout our week to talk about you more, to be a bigger part of our life, so that we can reach others with the gospel. And I pray all this in your holy and your mighty name. Amen. DCC, you are sent. Have a great week. If the elders will come up, if you guys need any prayer or anything that needs to be talked about, now is the time.